Hello, welcome to my video sample for my presentation on the topic of Sales Tactics Explained. This is a presentation that has a lot of application to a lot of people. Basically, everyone has to make purchasing decisions and business deals in your personal life, if not your professional life. And so this really has a lot of applicability. It's also important to note it's not just for consumers. This can also be useful for professional purchasing managers to help deconstruct some of the sales pitches that they might be hearing. And that's essentially what the purpose of this presentation is. I want to help people understand and see sales presentations and sales pitches and some of the strategy behind them, because that will help you differentiate between the style and the substance, and you will get straight to the substance and hopefully make better decisions as a result. Now, to illustrate that, I've got a few samples with me here I'm going to walk through. I'm going to start off with one that I call Focus on the Success Story. This is a very common sales tactic. They want to give you the best case scenario under the implication that that illustrates what you can expect. That's not necessarily the case. Say, for example, I'll illustrate this graphically. You have a product or perhaps an investment opportunity, and the result, they tell you, well, the last guy who got this, who purchased this investment or bought this product had a great result. Let's say this is dollars on an investment. They had a high dollar return or a high percentage return. But the thing that you have to remember is a salesperson has an incentive to give you the best case scenario. If you plot the probability of what people get versus the result, it's typically a bell curve. And this is a quasi-normal curve as best as I can hand draw one. And what you find is the result they're going to give you is typically aberrant. It's an unusually high result. You could also refer to this as ruling by exception. What you really want to know is what is the average and what is the expected variance. Is this narrow, meaning it's a very consistent result, or it's wide? And by the way, when I talk about probability, that means there are few people who have a low result and few people who have a high result, and most people are somewhere in the middle. Now, what if the cost of this investment opportunity were right here? They will tell you, well, look at this person. They had a high return and it covered their cost. But in reality, most people would not have that experience. And by the way, even though I'm telling you that the high result might not represent your result, but the average might not represent your result as well. For example, if you're particularly inexperienced in this area, you might actually skew towards the lower end. And if you paid this, you would really get a bad deal. So that's the focus on the success story. The next thing I want to talk about is what I call start with the answer, craft the questions. If you think about what you really want when you're making a purchasing decision or a business transaction decision, a business deal, you want to start out with a blank page and ask yourself, what do I want? And then you take those issues forward and see if you can find something that matches them. But interestingly, the salesperson oftentimes puts that equation backwards. They will start with the answer, buy my product or service, or if there's an options, buy my most profitable product or service, and then they will craft the questions that value what their product or their service offers. And I'll give you an example of this. There's a gentleman I know who sells real estate advice. He's basically selling books and lectures on buying properties as rental properties. And he'll ask you questions like, well, look, if your people are paying you rent for rental property, you're making money while you sleep. Do you want to be paid while you sleep? Or he'll say, do you want to work for someone else the rest of your life? This is an entrepreneurial venture and allows you to work for yourself. Now, for the record, I've known people who've had rental properties, and sometimes they end up with less sleep and more work. But the point is, those aren't necessarily the most important questions. For example, do you want to be paid while you sleep? Well, that depends. I would rather make a lot of money per hour while I'm awake and at work than make small amounts of money while I sleep. The sleep is actually not the issue. Likewise, do I want to work for myself? Well, that depends. If working for myself is hard and laborious and doesn't pay well, and I can find a job, a skilled job working for someone else, and yes, I do have to take directions, but it pays better and it has no risk and it's not necessarily a difficult job, then I would prefer to work for someone else. But you'll notice he didn't start with, what do you want to do with your life? What are your priorities? How much money do you want to make? He started out with the answers that lead you, he crafted the questions based on the answers that would lead you to his particular investment scheme. If he asked you about earning while you sleep and working for yourself, that would lead you to his his recommendation, his course of action. And this is one of the reasons I think it's very important before you walk into a transaction with a salesperson, you start out with the blank sheet of paper, either literally or figuratively, and ask yourself, what do I want out of this? What are the priorities? What do I want to avoid? And a lot of people don't make that mistake. They charge right in to the dealership, the sales rep, and immediately they've already, the sales rep will frame the transaction under the most flattering terms for themselves. Now, the last thing I want to talk about here, this is really sort of a laundry list of common mistakes. I call these confusing one thing with another. Oftentimes, for example, if you find someone who is very helpful, you will then, that will cast a halo effect over them, and you will then start to assume that they are very generous. Now, with sales reps, that's not necessarily the case. So, for example, if you study negotiation theory, they will tell you that information sharing can cut both ways. If I tell you what I want in a product or service, it can help you find that product or service for me, but you also, because you know that it has something I value, might be less willing to negotiate on price, therefore, or offer generous terms. So it's important to see the duality of information sharing. And that's oftentimes confused with, if we find someone who's very helpful, we will say they're generous, and so we will flood them with all of our information. There are a couple of ways in which this is particularly problematic in this day and age. One of them is the information that people can get from us from electronically. As information technology advances, when you go to a website to make a purchasing decision, they might already know a lot of things about you, where you live and what your interests are. And if they said, well, people in that zip code tend to pay more, they might give you a higher price. So sharing that information is particularly problematic. Also, in a day and age when we're under a lot of pressure, studies show that we're getting less sleep than ever. And I think it's fair to say that sometimes it can almost seem like nobody ever asks you for your opinion. Maybe your boss doesn't listen. Maybe your spouse doesn't seem to listen. Maybe your children don't seem to listen. And so if you actually have a sales rep that says to you, what do you want? You tend to flood them with, oh, finally, and you give them all the information. Now, some of that might be helpful to you, but some of them they might be able to use against you. And I talk a little bit about negotiation in terms of information sharing. I have a dedicated negotiation presentation, but I put a little preview of that in this presentation because I think it's relevant. Another common mistake, we tend to confuse friendly people with nice people. This is a very important distinction to draw. Particularly if they want something for you, people will oftentimes end up friendly. If you have a daughter, this is a very important lesson to teach her. For if she ever finds herself at a bar, maybe your daughter doesn't frequent such places, she will find many men who are friendly. That does not make us necessarily nice. Another common mistake, we start to confuse familiar with trustworthy. For example, if we are a member of a country club and we see this guy on the golf course every week, we might say, oh yeah, I know him, he's a great guy, very trustworthy. But the reality is we don't have any information to draw from this. All we know is that we see them frequently. If we haven't done business with them, we technically don't know how trustworthy they are. And oftentimes these can be related. For example, if we see someone on the golf course frequently and they're very friendly, we will start to recommend, oh, nicest guy in the world, trust him with anything. And those are really distinct decisions to make. You shouldn't allow that halo effect to confuse you. Another example of that is the similar versus aligned. Sometimes there will be an affiliation with the sales representative. Oh, we went to the same school, we were in the same fraternity, we're part of the same ethnic group, we're from the same country. And oftentimes you will mistake that for, well, therefore they must have the same interests are aligned because we're on the same team, however you wish to define team. But what actually happens is if you have a high level of confidence because of your affiliation and you give them a greater benefit of the doubt, they are actually better positioned to take advantage of that. And oftentimes, unfortunately, that's what happens is sales reps, some of the more aggressive sales reps will cultivate all of the affiliations that they have, and sometimes they will develop affiliations strictly for this purpose. And then once they've gotten into those affiliations and become familiar to those people and come across as friendly, they will then be better positioned to take advantage of their misalignment and oftentimes exploit those relationships. And the last thing I use here is the difference between gentle and sincere. Sometimes we confuse someone with a very gentle manner as seeming very sincere when in fact they're not necessarily. There's a politician I know who does this. If you look on the cable news shows and you see a lot of politicians arguing. Oftentimes it's very aggressive. There's a lot of table pounding, proverbial chest pounding. And this particular politician, he adopted a very grandfatherly tone. It seemed he was very quiet and he spoke slowly and he was very engaging and looked very sincere. And I think that that gentle approach made him seem more sincere, when in fact, if I look at his policies, he was as critical of his opponents as anyone. He was, depending on your ideology, I don't want to get into a political discussion, but the point is he really wasn't different in substance. He just adopted a manner that made him seem more sincere. And those are some things that you want to avoid. You could also call all of these sort of a halo effect. So those are some examples of some of the sales tactics that I think people need to be aware of. I've got a lot more in the live presentation. I hope you've found this interesting. And if you're interested, allow me to prepare a proposal for you. I look forward to doing business with you. Thank you.